Can you hear me?
Yes.
Those are, and this is Pastor, I guess, Pastor Juan. Oh.
Okay.
All right. We have a volunteer now helping in the boost, which we appreciate it. Thank you so much. All right, welcome to all who's worshiping with us online and also here in person. Please take a moment and fill out the one of the blue card that can be found in the pew, or fill it up online, the attendance form, just by scanning the QR code. This is how we keep our membership list up today, and then we love to drop a quick note if you're visiting us for the first time. Interest in giving to Trinity electronically, scan a QR code in the bulletin or text the number 407-809-1560 to get started. If you need a prayer, an elder will be available at the front of the right of the sanctuary after the service and pray for you and with you. The next FCA DYM gathering is a pool party and fishing event. It's on Sunday, July 14th at 3 o'clock. Please contact the church officer for additional detail, and we hope to see you there. Now through August 8th is our Peace Share fundraising, where Peace Comfort Dog collect donation for all creature pet grooming. Donation will include a dog or cat food, treats, toys, etc., or donations. Contact Paul Suits with any question. Additional details are in the weekly. So please stand and let us greet one another and share the peace of God. Before that, our pastor, guest pastor, wants to say something.
Okay, great. Well, I would like to just let the congregation know that Eduardo was called by Trinity at a voters meeting a couple weeks ago, and that he's now accepted our call after prayerful consideration.
Thank you.
And he's going to talk with you a little bit more about that, I guess, in the sermon.
Yes.
We're very thankful for his presence and joining our team.
Thank you. Welcome. Thank you. It is an honor and a pleasure to join your congregation, to join you, to be with you, and also together worshiping the Lord. So thank you. You guys made me blessed. Even though you say that I'm a blessed, I'm not. You made me a blessing for you to be with you. And thank you, the Lord, for extending this opportunity to worship with you always. Amen. Thank you. So now, let's stand and greet one another and share in God peace. God peace, my brother.
I'm so glad you accepted.
Thank God you bless. So much. How are you feeling? You doing good? Thank you, Madly. Thank you so much. Yep.
Congratulations.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you so much. Betty.
We're so happy.
Happy. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you,
so
Ben. Please remain stand while we do the invocation. And we invoke him, the God triune, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Please now may be seated. If we say we have not sinned, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's have a silence for refreshment. Let us then confess our sin to God, Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your way to the glory of the holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and from our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, and for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory be to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. O God, your almighty power is made known chiefly in holiness. Grant us the fullness of this grace that we may be called to your standard and may partake us of your heavenly virtues. Through the Jesus of the Christ, our Lord, who live and reign with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please may be seated.
Morning, guys.
Good morning.
Right. Our Old Testament reading today is coming from Ezekiel chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. He said to me, Son of man, stand on your feet and I will speak with you, as he spoke to me. The Spirit entered into me and set me on my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. And he said to me, Son of man, I send you to the people of Israel, to nations of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants also are impudent and stubborn. I send you to them, and you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord God, and whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they will know that a prophet has been among them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is coming from 2 Corinthians chapters 12, verses 1 through 10. I must go on boasting, though there is nothing to be gained by it. I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except for my weaknesses. Though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep me from being too elated by the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished, saying, where did this man get these things? And what wisdom was given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter's son, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor, except in his own hometown, and among his relatives, and in his own household. And he would do no mighty work there, except that he had laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went among them to the villages teaching. And he called the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2 and began and given them, he gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He charged them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not put on 2 tunics. And he said to them, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. And if any place will not receive you, and they will not listen to you, then when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent. And they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick, and he healed them. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O God.
Think about it.
I just realized that.
Thank you.
peace of God, our Father, and our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. For me, it is, and it always has been, an honor being here and doing preaching, doing the liturgy, participating with you. So thank you for this. And just a little side note, when I get the call for our Vice President, James Goodswill, he called me and then he let me know that there's gonna be a paperwork that I would receive. And I talk back to Pastor Callison and say, hey, I got a call, thank God. And then he said, no, don't worry, you're gonna receive the paperwork and it will be between Sunday, Monday. I said, oh, okay, good. So then on Tuesday passed, and then I called Pastor Callison and I said, hey, just an FYI, I have not received the document. And then I heard him say, like, we changed our mind. That was very bad, though, you know? It wasn't April Fool's, I mean, so it wasn't July right here. So that when you see that I am teasing him, yes, I admit it, I do, I tease him. But I just paying him back because the lot of teasing that he do to me, you are not aware of it. So I'm looking like the bad guy, but no, I'm an angel. I am, serious. Well, I wanna share with you today a message from chapter 6 from Mark. It's a keep going. It's a keep going. We need to also keep that in mind. We need to keep going in working in the vineyard of the Lord, vineyard of the Lord. Today's message is based on the test of the gospel. And this gospel that Mark was reading, it was sharing to the Gentile, the believers, a very essential information about who is Jesus and all what he had done. So the teaching today is also a test that it can show us that we must be firm following Christ. We need to be strong in our faith, and we have to stay always keeping our eyes on Jesus, following him. Sometimes we experience a rejection from those that we not expect that they can do that to us. Or rather from those that know us very well, that they grew up close to us. So it's really very difficult to take that. This rejection can confuse you. And it confuses you the most because it can cause you a doubt. Am I doing right? Am I okay? Because those are the closest people to you. And I can tell you, when I started in the church, I wasn't even just a member of the church. Then I went to I became treasury on the church. But then it was a little hard. When I start getting prepared to register for the seminary, that guy is gonna be able to be a pastor? Is he gonna be there? And people who know me close, they say, but I know him doing fine, but I never seen him doing the Bible. He know number, but he doesn't know the Bible. So that's how you can get limited on it. That's how you can get blocked. That's how you can feel that rejection when you're trying to do something. Sometimes Jesus, in the other hand, we can see how Jesus faced distractions from the rejection. And it was a rejection from his own people in his own town of Nazareth. So it is a little contradictory that after all the popularity that Jesus grabbed in Capernaum, that it was a city, very strategic city for all the commercial, all marketing over there. Because there was a lot of people coming from multiple areas, from different places, getting together. And in there, he did not get any rejection. But the surprise was that he got rejected by his own people. And then nobody is a prophet in their own land. A prophet is not without a honor except in his hometown and among his relative and in his own household. Carpenter. They failed to appreciate the wisdom and the miracle of Jesus of Nazareth. They reject all of that. And they dedicated themselves just to scandalizing and criticize all the work. Because to them, they only saw a carpenter whose mother, brothers, and sister they know. The skepticism of them, of these people, it made any revelation impossible, meaning like nothing would be happening there. So Jesus went with the power of God, with all the authority, to take care of any human need. He just decided not to show any sign from heaven to the skeptical adversary, who demand only a sign. But he could not perform any miracle at all to them. Non-belief does not allow us to open our hearts, to know the people through, much less to recognize the good work of Jesus. So despite of that rejection that Jesus experienced, this was not a reason for Jesus to stop doing what he was doing. He moved on. He kept going. Quite the contrary, we see how Jesus called, sent, and equipped his disciple just to go and bring the message of salvation to all the nation, healing sick people and cast out demons. Great job. Good thing, good mission. But note that Jesus was fully capable to work any miracle in Nazareth. But he decided not to. He decided not to share the divinity of his power, the dimension of all this miracle that he is able to do, because all the mockingly people dismiss him. Jesus' miracles were gift. And with the way we see, Jesus doesn't do any miracle because you demand him to do it. He gave it you for free. He's free, and he gave you that miracle. So therefore, he decided not to do anything on Nazareth and show the majesty, because the incredulity of this from Jesus down is a contrast with all the humble people that were in Capernaum that they were healed. The paralytic guy, a man that was paralytic, he woke up again. And the woman who had discharge of blood for 12 years, she also was happy, thankful for being healed. So rejection, in some cases, it might be a product of the memory, and the memory of our sins that is still there. There was a man in jail. He was in jail for 5 years, and someone came to ask him about what it makes his imprisonment so terrible. Would it be the thick of the wall, or the iron doors, or the forced labor that he was exposed to it? And he answered, no, that wasn't. And what made the prison so terrible was the memory. Thinking, always remember the bad thing. When we are a slave of our sin or our bad actions, the memory, it takes us away from God. It gets us so distant. But the worst is that this soul, these people, when we close our heart and we had the opportunity to hear the word of God, unfortunately, rejected. And we've been seeing people like that. When you talk and you share the gospel to someone, and that person just rejected. Don't talk to me about Jesus. So you can imagine how that is. So the same rejection of that, the bias of being a carpenter, that will be only a carpenter. Like when the people in Nazareth say, "Oh, Jesus, but that's the carpenter." It's kind of like you circle the people in what they are going to be, and that's it. That you don't picture anybody doing something else. And that's when you're getting a little problem. Because you are caught in the people's future. You are not letting that person. But talking about the people back in Nazareth, you can see the mindset. It was just the son of the carpenter. That's only a carpenter. How come he knows all of that stuff? And we know his brother. They are normal like him. That's what they look like. So probably that rejection and that mindset, it makes you hard to believe. So when we ask a brother, for example, in our church, when we have a brother or a sister to join us on a prayer, we can see themselves that they are look a little shy. I have one of our brother, our friend, and we ask him to pray with us. Have you been invited some friend of you and pray with you? Well, I have one, and I'm just gonna say the initial, not to get in trouble, but Roger Tulkey is a friend that he invite him sometimes to pray. And you know, the good thing or the joy in that is what we see on that person turning back. And you can see the joy. You can see how happy that person. That's how we help the others. And we avoid all rejections to encourage you to continue doing it, to do it, to keep up, to keep going. And this is Jesus that put aside all those rejections and continued his ministry, calling, sending, and his disciple, and sending to all the cities. That calling that we have cannot be wakened. Jesus called the 12 men to be his disciple. And this symbolic nature of this number, it is not a coincidental. Without a doubt, this was something that he presenting to reflect the 12 that he brought to their mind. When the Jew hear that number, they will remember that this is referring to the tribe of Israel. Jesus calling the 12. And was a symbolic act of visualize and illustrate the proclaiming verbally word that he said. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. The apostles were out there, and they, as we heard before in the reading, that they were supposed to depend to whatever comes to them. They were sent out without anything. But can you imagine being with Jesus, close to Jesus, and see how his people reject him. And then after that, he said, hey, go to this city and take the gospel and share the gospel with them. I would say, wait a minute, if they reject you, they will reject me more. Right? But the thing is, they did not ask, they didn't say anything. They just went out because Jesus sent them. And that's how we need to be, firmly following Jesus and go wherever. The mission of the disciple was in the same, foundation, which was to go and announce the gospel, the good news, the repentance. They believed that God is going to force them and to take them to spread the word. But you know, unfortunately, when they were announcing the repentance, those who do not repent have a false idea about repentance. They believe that God is going to force them to repent, to do it. It's kind of like I had to believe and it had to come something from heaven or from the sky, or lightning can hit me to convert and do repent. Or probably to feel a sense like, oh, I feel something, then I can repent. But this is not that. Repentance is not like that. A lot of people are waiting on something wrong and put the foundation on the wrong thing. For instance, I was trying to lose some weight, which I haven't, but I was trying to lose some weight. So then I registered in the gym. But it's been a long time that I haven't dropped any pounds. So I had to go physically to the gym and find out what's going on, because I had to do exercise, not by registering. That's exactly what happened with the people in the repentance. They expecting that something gonna come out or come down. So it is about, it is not about waiting for God to touch you. It's not about for God to tell you, hey, repentance. It's not about that. In good definition of repentance was asked to a soldier. They asked him how he had repented. And he answered this. The Lord told me to stop. Then he said, attention. Then he said, quite right, march. And that's words. Summarizing all of this is only one word, obeying. He just obeyed it. And Jesus drew his disciples close to himself to be part, employing them to be part of his extension, the extension of the messianic mission, proclaiming the good news, proclaiming the gospel. And we must see how, excuse me, Jesus continued his ministry, doing his best, and he knows that to doing this, moving forward, he will grow. He will grow and bring more people. Let's take a little moment. No, because I'm coughing. Let's take a look. And while what Jesus did, what we can learn, for example, what contemporary place best combine the hometown, best combine the work of the kingdom of God? You know who, what place is that one? You know who place is that one? Thank you so much. Excuse me. We know what place is that one. that place is the church. And the church, of course, is the place where we see acceptance, when we see warmth, when we see people that is practicing the spiritual gift. Cheers. When we experience the spiritual gift. So this is no, there is no better place or incubator to have our spiritual growth, to put in place our spiritual growth, to apply, to practice, other place than church. But why in church? Because this is the place where we have love, where we have a love, a congregation. And when we have a congregation welcoming, who receive everybody with the arm open. That's the best. That's the church. And that's how we do the mission. And that mission is exactly the same that the disciples of Jesus made. They expanded the ministry by sharing what? The gospel. And this is exactly what they were doing, sharing the gospel, but also were inviting the people to repent. And that was started by John the Baptist, followed by Jesus, and then us. So we need to keep up doing that. We need to focus and continue, because that is how we're going to be able to grow the ministry and the kingdom of God. This should give us an encouragement to follow Jesus Christ. Sometimes we feel like if nothing happened, or everything that I have done doesn't do anything. And we think like it's just a little drop. Oh, I don't know what's going on. In the sea. We think like what we have done is so little that just a little drop falling in the sea. But have you think that little sea drop, it could be missing for the sea? So whatever minimal thing that we do is gonna be missing from the sea. And we must move forward following Jesus Christ. Because after Jesus faced this insulting and circumstances, he continued teaching. He going village to village. And we too must move forward, regardless of the progress that we make. Because we know that all we need to do is just to plant the seed. And planting that seed, we can see how God can grow this. Not us, but God can do it. And we know, 1 Corinthians 3, 6, 8, 7. So keep going and keep working for God's kingdom, because in his church and outside is how we can be doing God's mission, keeping going and no afraid or rejection, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and mind in Jesus Christ. Amen. Please stand and let's boldly proclaim our faith using the word of the Apostle Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, making heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born by the Virgin Mary, suffered on the Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please may be seated. Apologize for that. Oh, that would be great, though. Thank you so much. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to our Lord, our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times give thanks to you in all places, and Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we angel and archangel, and we all the company in heaven, we loud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and singing.
As she approaches the ending stages of her life here on earth. We pray for those who are in the path of Beryl, Hurricane Beryl. Keep them safe, be prepared, and let them know that you, God, are their refuge. Pray for those who are traveling this summer. You give them safe travels, and that you also give them a refreshed and rested outlook after their vacations. We have continued prayers of health recovery for Tommy. I know it has begun well, and things continue to go well. Pray for Egbert Daniel. Praise God for recovery from sickness. We also pray for Dr. Daniel. Prayers for thorough and complete recovery and healing from sickness. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Beloved Heavenly Father, this your Trinity Church present before you our brothers, friends, and extended families in prayer. And we ask you for health, for a fast recovery, healing, comfort, peace, and for a strength in the loss of one, of the loved one. With faith, we ask you for a hope of good news for all of them. We especially mention Pastor Callison, Ulysses Floyd, Sharon Tyson, Davy and Judy Green, Diane, Brad Smith, and Catherine Simon. And we include in here all that we are having in our mind, in our thought, in this moment of silence. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Father, we thank you for hearing our prayers and granting our congregation another servant heart to serve your congregation and guide them in the path of righteousness. Bless the ministry that you are preparing for him among us, and grant that we may ever be willing to hear the voice of God, of your servant speaking in your name, so that he may joyfully carry out his ministry to your glory and your welfare, in Jesus' name. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our brother and sister in Christ, we read from the scripture that on the night our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. These do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he come. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Please may be seated. Yeah. I will be better. My brother, welcome to the table of the Lord. Take and eat the true body of Lord Jesus Christ. Take and eat the true body of Lord Jesus Christ.
After taking in the true body of our Lord Jesus Christ.
the true blood of Lord Jesus Christ shed for the forgiving of your sins.
Thank you.
Please stand. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. We give you thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord may his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Peace and serve the Lord. God's blessings.